Thank you all for coming. Next, we're going to have four lightning talks. So each of the speakers will come up here and they'll have 5 minutes. And if you could please hold all your questions at the end, we'll bring all the speakers back up if we have any time for questions. So first up, let's welcome David.
Thank you. Good morning, Mabuhay Kyor. I'm David from the Philippines. I live in Aotearoa, also known as New Zealand. I don't have slides, but imagine a map of the world with boundaries that are different than those that we use in our OpenStreetMap, VMAP, the one that we love. I've been thinking about indigenous mapping for a while. I'm not an indigenous person, but I'd like to be an ally. How many of you here is an indigenous person? Who is an indigenous person here? There's no one, and I think that's a problem. So I've been thinking about this for a long time. I'm kind of lost. So I have some reflections that I'd like to read to you. And maybe we can think about these things and have a long conversation. This might even take years. I also make maps, by the way. Okay. Number one, indigenous worldviews are fundamentally different from the ontologies and epistemologies that we have. In some cultures, the boundaries are not in the imagination. Like in our culture in the Pacific, my ancestor, we didn't have boundaries before the Spaniards came. Our islands were connected, and our stick charts and the shells were our maps, and these are relationships. And that's a fundamentally different type of cartography. Is it cartography? Okay. Next. I read a blog recently by Alan McConchies. He said, okay, maybe it's time for OpenStreetMap to map indigenous lands. And that's a nice idea, and people have been doing it to a lesser, greater extent. But does a certain or a particular indigenous group want to be mapped? We have to think about that too. Maybe there should be an OSM code for refusal. If they don't want to be mapped, then okay. What do you think about that? And if mapping should happen, then which knowledge must remain hidden and which knowledge must remain sacred? Because this is what I learned in Aotearoa. I came there, hey, let's do OSM. And then our Maori colleague said, well, I didn't know, David, you just came. And we have indigenous data sovereignty, which is a different concept than our property models that came from Europe. What does indigenous mapping mean and take? And are we supposed to be the map makers of this particular type of initiative? These are my last points. Okay. So what do you think should we discuss? How long does it take? What should we do? Why? For whom? With whom? What does this mean for both the social and technical part of OpenStreetMap? Where are the indigenous mappers of OSM? They're not here. And if they're not here, and we are going to prepare the space for that moment when there's an indigenous mapper in the next state of the map, in the data working groups, in the other working groups, in the board someday, how can we be a good OSM ancestor? Thank you very much.
Can I remove the stick? You copied it, right?
Yes. Okay, next, please welcome Disaster Mappers Heidelberg.
Oh. Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you all for being here. I'm from the Disaster Mappers Heidelberg. We are a group of researchers and students from Heidelberg who are interested in OpenStreetMap, especially interested in humanitarian street map. We usually organize local mappathons and sometimes hold workshops. But we've recently been met with a different challenge that I would like to tell you about in the next few minutes. We've been asked to gather all subnational administrative units in OSM. Subnational here meaning the administrative level directly beneath the nation level. And that turned out to be quite a bit more difficult than we imagined it to be, because we want to join it with thematic data. Joining is, in general, very easy from a technical perspective, but from the data perspective, it's a little bit more complicated because if you want to join two data sets, you need two common attributes for every feature. And that's not so easy to find in OpenStreetMap because of sometimes illegally mapped features. Therefore, we need to improve the tagging in OpenStreetMap. First of all, I would like to tell you about some methods we thought of for acquiring the data. Who has heard of Wambacher OSM before? Oh, very few, okay. Wambacher OSM is a site which offers a boundaries service. You can see, you can just click on the nations. You can also expand them to find the subnational units and export them in a lot of formats. It's a really great site. Unfortunately, it's not super well fitted for exporting, first of all the units, and it also limits the thematic data that can be exported. So the next thing we thought about is Overpass. It allows a very specific query to be run. You can ask for space, you can ask for thematic data, you can ask for users, you can also ask for edits and time slots. The problem is it's not really fit to handle a very large amount of data all over the world. So okay, what do we do next? We download Planet OSM, which is all OSM data. The smallest you can get it is almost 50 gigabytes, so it's not easy to handle. If you want to know more about OSM data acquisition and handling, we have three different workshops on OSM data on our homepage, disastermappers.wordpress.com/mapping. I will also show this at the end. Okay, so how are boundaries even tagged? Usually, the first two of the tags that you see here are the most important. You need to tag boundary is administrative and the administration level. For the level directly beneath the state, beneath Germany or UK, for example, the states in the United States are usually three or four. Four is much more common, but you will also find three, so there isn't a global standard for this. The name is obviously important as well. For us, especially important is the ISO 3166 level 2. This is a standard that globally assigns a short string to every subnational unit, and this is what we would preferably use for our joins because it has proven to be very challenging to properly join on the names, because the names sometimes are in English in your dataset and native in OpenStreetMap. They sometimes contain additions just as province or region or state, sometimes in English, sometimes in native language. So it's not easy to join these. It's also not easy to correct yourself because it's almost 3,000 features. You can also add more like Wikidata, English names, or any names. It's best if you check your local units because, as I told you, it can be level 3, it can be level 4, so it is good if you know the area where you're mapping. Note that admin level is also used for government buildings. That's important, so you need boundary administrative to identify it. We identified almost 300 units with missing tags. I uploaded a comrasubit values data where you can find the names, the IDs in OpenStreetMap. So please feel free to have a look at them, and if you find any that you know, I would be very happy if you can add some of the tags that I told you or that you can think of. I'm very thankful for your attendance and any help you can give us. You can find us on disastermappers.wordpress.com. You can find us on Twitter and reach us on via email. The workshops that I mentioned earlier are also on the homepage. Thank you very much.
Okay, next we're going to hear from Toshikazu about map compare. Sure.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. I'm talk about only you can memory to the map compare JP just launched 3 days ago. So I'm honored to talk about this Germany State of the Map Conference to launch the Map Compare Japanese version, right? So anyway, our Japanese researcher group focus on the trust of the crowdsourced geographic information since last 2 years ago. So we are now analysis to the, for example, so not only the OpenStreetMap data, but also the VGI data quality assessment, and also we are focus on the user motivation. So anyway, we are now just started to the launch the Japan map compare, and also we can you access to the GitHub to any code. So aim of the developing the map compare Japanese version, the this site can compare the various web maps focus on the recently all the web map services. Of course, the OpenStreetMap and Bing, Google, Esri, and in Japanese map agency can publish the map farm, and also the geospatial information institute of the Japanese map agency. It is also the inspired by the original map compare coded by the GeoFabric. Thank you so much to GeoFabric website, right? It is developed using the modern web mapping technology like Leaflet, the Vue.js, and also the you can show the via the Node.js application. So this site is developed with Mielune in Japanese map company, so focus on the OpenStreetMap data. So anyway, we can now access to the map compare JP. And also, our site is comparative in web map contents about the maximum is 8 pattern to recent map shows. So anyway, we can now develop to the link to the static links, so panels, zooms, and latitude, longitude, and some web map patterns to memorize to you can use this one. And also, we are scalable to lead to the via smartphone application. You can show the, some compare to the web maps to using the smartphone. So anyway, our map compare license is this by the BSD license. So you can always show and using the map our map compare JP website. So thank you again for original map compare developed by GeoFabric. So. Anyway, to show me the video. So you can compare to the some we are now attached some map services. Of course, we are planned to next stage to other map web map services is included this site. So not only you can show the in Japanese area, but also the this version is a worldwide show. However, the only the Japanese area to be matched to data dataset. So you can show the this is a full screen. And that's the six type of the screen type. And maximum size is 8 sites. Okay, please touch the our application. So thank you so much.
Our fourth speaker is Etienne about Quick OSM.
Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm going to show you two tools that I'm working on. Okay. No problem. So I'm going to show you two tools that I'm working on to use OSM vector data in QGIS. So the first one is called Docker OSM. I can't explain to you what is Docker, but Docker OSM is like a PostGIS database with automatic updates of the OSM database. So it's a Docker Compose project with three containers in it. So you have ImpOSM, PostGIS, OSM update. So the idea is like quite simple. You take just one simple PBF file, and you put it in the specific folder of Docker OSM, and you just press, you just do make run. And the idea is like your PBF file is imported into the PostGIS database. So you have all your layers created following what you did in the ImpOSM default configuration. And automatically, every 2 minutes, this system will be updated with the live OSM data. And it's possible to customize this configuration, so you can set up like custom URL for the diff files, default update interval. You can also add some extra SQL queries, like if you want to have some index triggers, views. And also some QGIS styles are included in the database. So when you load them from QGIS, you may have like some default styles already. So it's on GitHub, like you have the address. That's the first tool that I'm using to use vector data in QGIS. And the other one is a plugin. So you can either work with local PBF files also, or you can use queries with Overpass. So you can ask one key, by default, it will download all OSM data. If you let the key and the value empty, then you can define one key or one value that you want to query with the Overpass. And then for the extent, we try to do what Overpass Turbo is doing. So you may like have a in-around query, like in a specific area, or you can have you can use layer extent, map canva extent. And QuickOSM is also providing some default actions that some people may not know. But if you want, you can edit OSM fetches, and it will launch either ID or JOSM straight from QGIS. And QuickOSM will also parse the data that you downloaded. So if you have some mapillary links, or Wikipedia or Wikidata, it will just offer you the link to open the web page, or here you can see that I'm just opening the GoTo Mapillary plugin. Then, if you already used OSM data within QGIS, you usually have this HTOR field in QGIS. It's not very convenient to work with. So just keep in mind that you can either use QuickOSM to load your local file, it will just explode the HTOR field, or start using QGIS 3.4 or 3.6. There is no better support for HTOR field, so it will explode your. There is a native algorithm in QGIS 3.6 where you can explode your HTOR field. And also, you can also in QGIS build some graphical models. So I don't know if you are used to it. You can like build some models with some inputs, some algorithm, and some outputs. So you can use QuickOSM within the graphical model builder. So for instance, here I'm just using one input. It's an extent. When I say, OK, I'm building a query, so it's emergency equal fire hydrant. Then I'm downloading the query, and I'm like the query will come in 4326 with degrees, so I want everything in meters. So I'm just doing a reprojection in my local CRS. And I'm doing a buffering, so I get then at the end like two layers, one for fire hydrant and one for area. So when you have like, you can have some presets with some queries already like saved in your QGIS. So I just double click on fire hydrant on the right, and then the model will execute by itself, and I have two layers at the end. So you can like just use every algorithm from QGIS, like buffering, reprojection, intersection. And yeah, so I'm always looking for help, translations, documentations. I have plenty of ideas for QuickOSM, like to have like map presets where you don't need like to know the key, the value. To have like, for instance, bicycle maps. Integrate GeoSM presets also, whatever. Well, I have some ideas, so yeah, that's it. It's available on QGIS and on GitHub also.
Thank you. So we do have a couple minutes for questions. So if the speakers want to all come up here, we can take a couple questions. And then after this is the coffee break, so you can also find the speakers there. So any questions?
Hi, for the QuickOSM, there is an easy way to import in the Docker OSM with our own schema? Not the import OSM schema?
For Docker OSM, I was just using the default import OSM file, but that's you can customize it. When you download the project, you can customize layers that you want. Attributes, tags, and if you want a generalized version of your table, that's all possible in ImpoSM. Yeah.
Yes, I'm on. I have a remark and a question for the first speaker. You're raising a very important point of mapping indigenous people and indigenous people territories. I'm afraid you're posing questions that cannot be answered in general. You know, they are very location specific. And one question that I would like to pose to you is the following. As OpenStreetMap is trying to near completion in local context, the question is going to be whether the data that we have is perceived from an open world perspective or from a closed world perspective. And what is meant by that is whether you can assume that what is not there, it doesn't really exist. And you know, in the open world perspective, you don't believe that, you think there's always more. In the closed world perspective, you assume what you have is all that's there. And that is a very fundamental point that you need to raise when you come to indigenous peoples mapping, because it will tell you something about that. And what is important there is what is the law of the country telling you are indigenous peoples' rights. And with that, you can possibly play this. And so to come back, to give you an example of this, you posed us the question, are there any indigenous people here? And I was posing myself the question, well, define indigenous for me, because, you know, I feel like I'm indigenous to where I live, because I was born there and all my family was born there, but I don't think you meant that. Yeah. So you know, what does it mean to be not indigenous? It's a reverse question. So my question to you is, does this, what I just said, does this apply to your the case that you have in front of you? How are people's rights absorbed in the local law? Are there sentiments for not being mapped, and what would those be?
Yeah. Thanks for that. I can at least even in a tangential way respond. First, it's about the open and closed world perspective. I think we also need. Thank you for that. These are wonderful. This is wonderful insight. I think we need to also ask about the basis of that. Why is it open? What does it mean? What does closed mean? Because it comes from a particular value system, just to add. Because whenever I talk with our indigenous colleagues, even map makers, they say, well, I know, David, you studied this, GIS, etc. But in our community, not everything has to be shared to the world. And maybe that's the way it is. About the thing that's in front of me, what's in front of me, I think, is maybe a conversation. That's all I can do. Again, I am not trying to lead an initiative or et cetera, but I think there has to be a conversation, and the things that you said, maybe it depends on the country, maybe it depends on their laws. What does it mean to be indigenous? And even the term indigenous varies per country. Maybe it's case-to-case basis. Maybe this is not the responsibility of OpenStreetMap. It's also possible. Maybe there has to be another group. That could sound provocative to you, but whenever I go to other communities, well, David, if you trace our buildings, the military is going to come and bomb our village. And they're going to get our forests, and they're going to get our mines. And okay, I'm going to step back and not make a map. So these are just thoughts. I'm also kind of lost right now. But thank you for that. Thank you very much.
Can I take one more question?